Hi friends, I'm Shweta from RSA Legal Solutions in India. Today we will be having a very, very small session on the various opportunities for investing in India and their corresponding tax benefits available in India from direct and indirect tax perspective both. So I'll be sharing a small PPT here. Just a minute. Yeah. Why one should invest in India? Why invest in India? Because of the rising infrastructure, largest youth population, huge domestic market, rising economic influence, rising global competitiveness, one of the fastest growing economies, ease of doing business, abundant natural resources, one of the leading technology hubs. So these are the reasons which are well known to the world as to why one should invest in India. The basic reason and the primary reason for all of these is that India has a huge population, which makes it a consumption-based country. And therefore, it's the rising, because of the rising economic influence, there is an ease of doing business in India, because of the various strategies which are laws and strategies which are being brought by the government of India. So because of all these reasons, one can think of investing in India. Which are the emerging sectors in India? Agriculture, automobile, electronics, banking, construction, healthcare, oil and gas, e-commerce and media. However, one may decide on its own as to under which sector they may want to invest in India. FDI entry routes in India. So before proceeding, it's very important to know that as to how a person can enter into India, set up in India and do business in India. It's very important to know the FEMA regulations in this regard. So there are basically two routes which are given under the FEMA regulations for entry into India. One is the automatic route and the other is the government route. When we say the automatic route, under the automatic route, there is no approval required from anybody. 100% FDI is permitted in the automatic route. And the examples could be like agriculture, coal mining. So you just have to come in India, have an entity in India in the prescribed sectors for the automatic 100% FDI route. And there is no approval required, get otherwise other licenses and registrations and start your business right away. The second is the government route. In government route also, there are many sectors where 100% FDI is permitted. But however, the prior approval of the government of India from the respective ministry or the department is required, for example, establishment of satellite. So you are allowed 100% FDI, but you have to form you have to take the approval of the government of India. There, it's not automatic. So once you obtain the approval, only then you can conduct the business in India. The third is the sector. It's not third, I would say. In fact, it's a mix of both automatic and government. There are sectoral caps. When I say sectoral caps, it typically means that on particular sectors, there are sectoral caps which are applicable beyond which the investment in India is not allowed. In that case, it could be under the automatic route also, it could be under the government approval route also. So for example, if in a sector, the FDI is allowed say up to 49% under the automatic route, then in that case, a person from outside India can invest in India up to 49% in that particular sector without taking any approval. However, if he needs to go beyond 49%, it's quite possible that he may not be allowed at all to go for the investment at all, or it could be possible that if beyond that limit is required to be invested, then the government approval is required. Examples are defense and telecom. Then there is last is prohibited sectors in which FDI is completely prohibited, in which the foreign investors cannot invest at all. Chit funds, lottery, gambling, etc. So it's very, very, so before coming to India, it's very, very important to get a feasibility study done as to whether and up to what extent the FDIs are allowed into India. Now, when you come into India, setting up business in India, so what are the entities, legal entities formation, which are recognized in India and how can you come into India? One is the Indian company, foreign company, and limited liability partnership. These are the three ways in which you can set up your business in India and give it a legal entity. So as far as Indian company is concerned, the foreign investors can form a joint venture in India with an existing Indian company, or they can form their wholly owned subsidiaries in India. As far as the foreign companies are concerned, they don't work as an Indian company, but they establish in India some liaison office or a branch office or a project office. All the three have different functions to perform, different permissions to perform for the activities which they want to engage in. So depending upon what kind of, for example, the project office. Project offices are allowed only for particular projects. So if there is some foreign party who has some project going on in India or will be having any project in India, they don't want to establish a full and permanent settlement in India, but they want to have some sort of project office in India. So in that case, they can establish a project office. So there are restrictions also as to what a project office can do and cannot do. Similarly, we have limited liability partnership if the foreign investor doesn't want to opt for the company method by joint venture or wholly owned subsidiary. They may even form an Indian LLP. LLP is limited liability partnership under the LLP Act 2008. So one has to be very careful in choosing what should be the business setup in India depending upon their purpose, the restrictions applicable, the benefits available, etc. Business registration process, setting up the legal existence of the entity, getting the required business approvals and licenses, and you go, then you can commence the business. So you first have to set up your legal existence, whether like in the previous slide we saw, whether in the form of the Indian company or the foreign company or the LLP. Then you have to take the requisite approvals and licenses accordingly, and accordingly you can commence your business. What are the key approvals and licenses which are required? One is the certificate of incorporation from the registrar of companies, director identification number, permanent account number, GST registration, IECs, importer exporter code number, without which a person cannot import or export the goods and the services from India, registration of tax account number, MSME registration, if applicable. MSME is micro, small and medium enterprises. So in India, there are certain, there is an MSME Act, which confers various benefits to micro, small and medium enterprises. So if the turnover is as per the threshold limits prescribed under the MSME Act, one can opt for the registration under the MSME Act also and thereby get those benefits under that particular act, though it is not mandatory. BIS license if it is applicable, Environment, Forest and Wildlife Clearance if applicable, IEM, EM registration if applicable. The last one is typically applicable for those cases where the companies want to take the state subsidies and the state benefits which are provided by the respective states in India. In that case, they need to have some IEM number. These are just the key approvals and licenses. This is not an exhaustive list. So depending upon the nature of the business, there may be many more registrations and licenses which a person is required. Or in fact, depending upon these business, there could be many of these which are not even applicable to them. So it depends upon case to case basis. Tax structure in India. This is a very, very important point to be kept in mind by the companies whenever they try to invest in some other country. They should know the tax structure in that particular country. Only then they will be able to analyze and evaluate the profitability for their investment. So in India, we have the direct taxes and the indirect taxes. Direct taxes, when I say, it's the income tax, stamp duty and registration, property tax. Indirect taxes is GST and customs duty. So direct taxes are typically which are borne by the person themselves and they're not passed upon, but indirect taxes are passed upon, may or may not be passed upon. Now, income tax, direct tax. So this income tax is levied under the Income Tax Act on the income of a person which is administered by the central government. This is a central levy. And it's applicable to individuals, companies, firms, LLPs, association of persons, and other artificial juridical persons. And under the Income Tax Act, the income is classified and accordingly taxed under five heads of income. Those five heads of income are income from salaries, income from house property, profits and gains from business or profession, capital gain, income from other sources. So when we talk about the companies, maybe companies or any other form, when they operate in India, for them, the relevant head of income is profits and gains from business or profession. They will be taxed under this head. However, when we talk about the expats coming to India and their taxation is concerned, it's the income from salaries under which they will be taxed. Under the profits and gains from business or profession, there are under all the heads, in fact, there are certain deductions which are allowed, and like when I talk about profits and gains from business or profession, and the expenses which are incurred in the business, those deductions are allowed from the arriving at the total assessable value, and accordingly the tax to be paid on. So for expats, salaries is relevant, but for profits and gains from business or profession, it is relevant for the businesses. However, there may be one more angle to it, which is when the foreign companies make investment in India, there may be angle from the capital gains perspective also, as to because they will be investing in India, and then when they are selling their portion of the shares in India, so that may be attracted at that point in time. There might be implications from the dividend perspective also, because in India the tax is levied when the dividends are given to the the shareholders. So in that case, one has to carefully see, being the foreign investors, whether as to what rate the dividend taxation would be applicable for them in India. There are certain incentives as well under the direct tax, which are applicable to the new businesses. One is the investment link to incentivize investment in certain sectors. Any capital expenditure incurred for specified businesses is allowed as a deduction in the year in which it is incurred. The incentive is available to certain specified businesses, which include, among others, laying and operating a cross-country natural gas, crude, petroleum pipeline, production of fertilizers. Just a few of them I have named. So investment link, based on the investment which you do, there may be cappings in this. So based on the investment which you do, there are certain capital expenditures benefits which are allowed as a deduction in the year in which it is incurred. Then you have Startup India scheme. In this scheme, this is eligible to startups, and they enjoy a tax holiday for a consecutive period of 3 years from initial 5 years in respect of 100% of their profits. So this under this scheme, the entities which are eligible for this scheme are, if it works towards innovation, development or improvement of products or processes or services. So in that case, they can take the benefit of the startup scheme. So basically, the entities which are in technology, which are into development of technology, innovation, improvement of products or some processes. So in that case, they can take the benefit of the Startup India scheme and get a tax holiday for a consecutive year period of 3 years. Then third is also very, very important for those businesses who are into rendering of financial services. They can set up their businesses in India in the International Finance Service Center and provide their services from the International Finance Service Center to the customers who are located outside India. In that case, the companies are offered concessions on capital gains, minimum alternate tax, dividend distribution tax, etc. So people who are outside India into financial sectors, they can think of setting up their businesses in the International Financial Service Center in India. Now let's come to the indirect taxes, goods and services tax. GST has been recently launched on 1st July 2017 in India. Prior to this, there were many, many taxes at the central level and the state level, which used to be applicable on the businesses, and which were little difficult to be monitored because of so many taxes, so many authorities to be reported to, etc. But now all those taxes have been subsumed into GST, and there is only one tax, GST, which is applicable now. So it is basically a step towards ease of doing business in India, and actually it has eased the problems on the businesses a lot. However, it has a dual model on which both central and state levies the taxes. Though it's not complicated, it's very, very simple to be understood. In GST, we have the central GST, state GST, union territory GST, integrated GST. It seems, four types of GSTs which are applicable. The answer may not be really so, because it depends upon the type of transaction which you enter, which will govern whether CGST, SGST will be applicable, or UTGST will be applicable, or the integrated GST. For example, if you are making an interstate supply of goods or services, interstate is within two states, then in that case, integrated GST would be applicable. However, if you are making the supply of goods or services in India, which is within the same state, in that case, it will be central GST and state GST or UTGST, which would be applicable. The rate of all these central CGST and state CGST and integrated CGST are same. So it's pretty easy, not that much complicated. What are the benefits of GST now? Minimal physical interface, reduced compliance cost, no cascading of taxes, robust IT-based administration, unified tax regime for both goods and services. With all these benefits actually were not there in the previous regime. That is the reason why we are highlighting it here. When I say minimum physical interface, so in that case, it's completely IT-driven, the GST portal. So whether you have to file your returns, whether you have to claim your refunds, whether you receive any show cause notices, whether you have to file replies to your show cause notices or whatever. So if there is, it's not, you're not required to go to the department again and again, and it's minimal physical interface is there. Everything is system driven. Reduced compliance cost. As I pointed out earlier also that before GST, there were many, many taxes which were applicable. So person had to file returns under all those taxes, be reporting to all the authorities, different authorities. So there was a huge cost for the companies which was applicable. But now under the new regime, under this GST regime, the compliance cost has reduced a lot. So because now it's only GST, there is only one authority to which a person has to report, and only one type of returns that are required to be filed. No cascading of taxes. When I say no cascading of taxes, it simply means that whatever taxes you have paid on input side on procurements, those are available as credit while discharging of your outward tax liability. So therefore, it's not tax on tax, which was a big problem in the erstwhile tax regime. Robust IT-based administration, this I've already explained. So it's a huge portal, and everything is governed through that portal only. Unified tax regime for both goods and services. So it's not that goods are having a separate law, services are having a separate law. It's the unified tax regime for both. So all the provisions of the GST law, everything is applicable for both goods and services except for the minor exceptions. One of the important taxes in India and globally also is the customs duties. So this is a central levy in India. Whenever the goods are imported or exported from India, the Customs Act comes into picture. When the goods are imported into India, the customs duties include basic customs duties, integrated tax, and GST compensation cess, which are applicable. GST's compensation cess is not applicable in all the products, but on given specified products. Similarly, additional duties such as anti-dumping duties, safeguard duty, NCCD, are also levied on certain goods. These are also not applicable on all the goods, but depending upon case to case and from which country the goods are being imported, these duties may be applicable. Export promotion in India. Why I'm discussing is because when a business is set up in India, apart from the domestic sales which it makes, it also makes the supplies of goods and the services outside India. So basically it exports the goods and also the services outside India. There are so many MNCs here in India as of now who are working as a subsidiary to the foreign parent company in India and who are providing services to their overseas company in India. And they earn foreign exchange for India and accordingly get the benefits in terms of the export promotion incentives. So I'll discuss one by one in brief. One is the SEIS. In this scheme, the service providers of the notified services located in India shall be rewarded under this scheme at the rate specified under the foreign trade policy. So there are notified services, and it's not a small list, it's a very big list of the service providers. And if the business in India is providing those services out to a customer outside India and getting the foreign exchange for the country, then in that case, they are rewarded under the foreign trade policy at a specified percentage. As of now, the percentage varies from 5% to 7% of the net foreign exchange earnings which they do. So if a business net foreign exchange earning is say 100 CR in India, then in that case 5 to 7%, which is basically 5 crores or 7 crores, in that case they will be entitled to that benefit, which is a big benefit for all the exporters of services in India. They will be given this benefit by way of duty credit scripts, which will be tradable. They can sell those scripts to any person who requires them for fulfillment of their import duty obligations. And in that case, so it's a basically very good incentive which is being given by the government of India to promote export of services from India. Similar to the SEIS, we have the MEIS scheme. That was for the services. This scheme is for the goods. So in MEIS scheme, there are notified goods which if exported from India, the government gives a benefit to those exporters in the form of a percentage, in form of a duty credit slips, which are a percentage of their net foreign exchange earnings, just similar to the SEIS. So in this case, the percentage varies from 3 to 5%, which again is a very, very good incentive for any exporter exporting the goods from India. Then we have advance authorization scheme. In this scheme, it allows duty-free import of inputs that are required for manufacturing the export product subject to certain conditions. The exporter has to fulfill the export obligation within the specified period, both value and quantity wise. So basically in this scheme, the importer of goods can import the raw materials, the inputs for manufacture of the goods which are to be finally exported. So if a person knows that he has the export orders in hand and he requires the inputs for them, he can import those inputs duty-free completely. And he will be given a target of export which he has to fulfill. And once he fulfills, so basically his export obligation is fulfilled. So this is a very good scheme and it saves a lot and lot of customs duties by the importers since their goods are finally exported out of India. Just similar to the advance authorization, we have the Export Promotion Capital Goods Scheme, EPCG scheme. The advance authorization scheme was for the raw materials and the inputs. The EPCG scheme is for the capital goods. So if a business in India knows that their products would be exported from India and they require any capital machinery in India, in that case, they can import the capital machinery from outside India without payment of any customs duty. And similar to the advance authorization, there will be an obligation that would be fixed upon them, which they will have to fulfill in certain number of years. And once fulfilled, it gives them the benefit typically by way of not paying any customs duties on the import of such capital goods. Then we have a duty drawback scheme. Under this scheme, provides a rebate of duty on inputs used in the export product. Drawback shall be available for any duty paid material, whether imported or indigenous, used in the export goods. So when you are exporting, this benefit is available under the Customs Act. So when you're exporting the goods from India, then in that case, the government allows you to get a duty drawback on the export of goods as a percentage. For some products, it's 1%. Normally ranges from 1% to 2%. This is basically to compensate the tax paid on the imported goods or the goods procured from within the country. So it's just a fixed percentage and you don't have to show any correlation with your inputs or anything. And the best part of duty drawback is that it automatically gets credited once you export the goods. It automatically gets credited to your account. So there is no physical interference here also. Recently, the government of India has also come up with a new scheme, which is the bonded manufacturing. So this is typically like you have a premise in which you import the raw materials, capital goods and spares without any payment of customs duties for manufacturing in the bonded warehouse facility. If you are, customs duty is payable only if the goods are sold in the domestic market. No duty payable on export of goods. So if you are importing the goods and then you're manufacturing the final item and then you are exporting, then no customs duty is at all to be paid. However, if you've imported the goods, you have manufactured the goods and you have made the domestic clearance in India, then in that case only the customs duties would be applicable. This is a recent scheme and a very, very good scheme. In fact, it surpasses all other schemes person can choose basis the business model he has, basis the customers he has, basis his commercials, as to under which scheme he would want to go. Before we end the session, this kind of PPT was thought to be delivered is that before entering into India, it is very, very advisable to any business to get a feasibility study done for the options of entering into India, the tax benefits available in India, whether it's direct tax benefits or the indirect taxes benefit, the kind of registrations required, whether they are allowed under the FDI sector or not. It's recommended that the complete comprehensive feasibility study should be undertaken and then only decided as to how to enter into India. All these things I have explained in very, very, very crisp manner, but these are, believe me, very, very detailed schemes. So in case a person is interested, a detailed write-up or an overview can be shared with him. Now something about us. We are RSA Legal Solutions. We are a law firm who is based in Gurgaon, and we are specializing in customs, indirect taxation, international taxation, income tax, and other allied laws, many other laws basically. Our firm was founded by Mr. S.C. Jain, who has an experience of more than 37 years in dealing with various types of indirect taxes in India. Also, all other partners, including me, we all are from Big Four, and a team of experienced lawyers and industry professionals with a wide area of functional expertise and domain experience. In case one is interested, we can share the detailed profile of RSA Legal Solutions. We also some awards and achievements which we have. RSA Legal Solutions was recently featured in top 20 recommended lawyers in India by Business Connect magazine in 1920. It was also chosen in top 5 finalists in the category of Best Startup Law Firm of the Year, awarded by the prestigious IDEX Legal Awards. The firm was also awarded with the top 10 GST Consultants Award by the famous Insight Success magazine. This is about us, and I hope you like this session. Thank you very much. Thanks.